Yeah, and I'm going through, you know, I'm going through all the directors and the people you worked with, and I'm always amazed. I mean, you know, that's a who's who. I mean, because the directors I see, Lumet, Woody,
yeah,
De Palma, Nichols.
De Palma was a dream. I love.
I just saw the documentary about him the other day.
Yeah.
I saw. I mean, who else? You got everybody. Wes Anderson, the Coen brothers.
Oh, wow.
I mean, every one of these guys. I mean,
I'm going to work with those guys again for sure.
Oh, everybody loves him.
Yeah.
Charlie Durney used to tell me because they loved him. They loved him. My friend, may he rest, another one who messed with peace, Trey Wilson. I don't know if you knew of Trey. He played when we did Bull Durham together.
Yeah.
And he played Nathan Arizona. And he was on his way to play Miller in Miller's Crossing when he had a brain aneurysm and died. And that's how Albert Finney got the part. But it was written for him. And but the Coen brothers, although I actually auditioned for them for the last movie they did, Hail Caesar. But
they're very loyal men.
They are. I mean, do they treat their people? I mean, do they direct much? Are they like Woody? I mean,
you come in with a script there's almost no changes.
Right.
It's just right.
Right.
And they trust you. There is a very gentle direction, but not much.
Like Woody doesn't direct at all, right?
Very little.
Yeah.
Almost nothing.
Who did I talk to?
Somebody kind of drives me crazy because I wanted to do well for him so much.
Everybody does.
Yeah.
Hey, you didn't get fired. That's if you don't get fired for Woody, that's a good job.
I tell you, everyone's like holding your breath.
Yeah, I mean, because it is true. Everybody gets fired in the middle of Woody's movies. I had who was it?
David, I mean, the biggest are afraid of getting fired. It's great.
David Ogden Stiers did it. He goes, I've done 3 or 4 movies to him. And I met him on my street one day, and we started talking briefly. And he said, that's more of a conversation than I've ever had with him.
Yeah.
He says, there's no conversation or anything. Now, what was Nichols like?
Nichols was, he was good, but what he did was trust his people a lot. And he picked some good people. We could have used a little more help from him. He trusted too much. I had a feeling that, I mean, God rest his soul, he was getting a little tired.
Okay.
And he didn't supply what I think he could have. He could have given more to those brilliant comedian actors. But we did a good job anyway. It was a good show.
That was the Waiting for Godot, right?
That's right.
And you were with who? Was that Robin and Steve Martin?
Robin and Steve Martin, yeah. And they were good. They were really good. But also
Had Steve done any theater before then?
I don't think so.
Robin at least came from Juilliard and had a background.
Yeah. But Steve's last speech in that was brilliant. Really, really great.
Yeah, I wish I'd seen that before. I didn't see that one. Oh, I knew Robin really well.
I mean, how do you explain him to anyone who doesn't know him? It was like a volcano. It was never-ending lava coming out. This amazing wellspring of invention and creation. I've never seen anything like it.
Robin,
I loved him.
I met Robin first in 19, we were both Cops Comics starting out together in 1976, 77, just before Mork.
I imagine he was always that way.
Well, he was, but if you got him one-on-one, I mean, now I did the Good Morning Vietnam with Robin, so we spent a lot of time together.
Uh-huh.
And Robin was a very, I won't say serious, but Robin was a very thoughtful guy. I mean, Rob, you could have conversations about anything with Robin. Robin will talk to you about any subject, science, architecture. You know, he would talk about any subject. He was brilliant. There was a sadness around Robin a little bit. But I also have to say, Robin Williams, as great and as genius as he was inventive, he was a better human being. Robin was, you talk about causes and sticking your neck out for causes.
Yeah.
See, Robin would be there in a second for anything.
Quietly, too.
Yes, he was a San Francisco comic. And when the AIDS, when AIDS broke out, I knew at least 3 comics that he was supporting under the table.
Yeah.
Unbeknownst to his wife, who would not have given the money at the time. But no, Robin was really...
Interrupted your thought, I'm sorry. But
no, that's fine.
He was a great man.
But at the same time, I remember, believe it or not, I remember the commercials. I remember the
fruit. Oh, that was fun.
The Fruit of the Loom. I remember that.
Yeah.
I said, there's the guy. You know who else? I mean, I remember because I was in the acting department in Houston, and we would watch shows like The Electric Company. Mm-hmm. And the electric company, and I'd see this actor, and I'd say, this guy's really, because you can actors know who's good just by watching them.
Yeah.
We'd say, this guy's good. And it was Morgan Freeman.
Yeah.
Before all that, you know. Yeah. In fact, when I brought it up to him a couple of times, they said, you know, he really doesn't like that. And I said, oh, I'm sorry I brought it up. He goes, no. And I imagine when you're first starting out, the electric company.
See.
But no, he's fine with it now.
I did a lot of commercials.
Yeah.
That was a fun world, man.
Yeah.
I think over 90% of the commercials that were made here in New York or came out of New York. It was a great living.
Well, yeah, it's like
it was fun.
It was commercials. If you were on the East Coast, it was commercials. If you were a comic on the West Coast, how I made my living was going on The Dating Game. I would be a different contestant.
Did you really?
I would be a different character every week.
Oh, we'd love to see you.
I went on one
you.
Time as Lawrence
what
Talbot.
Fun.
That was the name I gave Lawrence Talbot, which was the Wolf Man.
That's right.
You know, and I would go on somebody. I went on three or four times. I won a couple of times. I went on the date once with me and the girl and the chaperone. He got laid. Unbelievable. The chaperone got laid. Unbelievable. But that's how I made my living. I mean, it's like you paid my rent.
Let me tell you a quick one about the early days here, yeah, when I was here in New York. It was Life Soap Opera. It was over on this at CBS, and I had a little job, and it was in a jail, and the star, one of the young stars, was in the cell next to me, and I said something like, "Hey kid, you know, you like peanut butter sandwiches?" He said, "No." I said, "Well, I do. I'll give you my candy bar for your peanut butter sandwich." And that was about the end of it. So about 3 weeks later, they called me again. I said, "Do you mean the kid's still in jail?" They said, "No, now this time you play a hairdresser." I said, I just did a prisoner, a thief. Aren't they going to question it? Aren't those people going to... He said, "Murray, they're not looking at you." That should be the name of my book. "They're not looking at you."
That's a good title. I had my first day. I was talking about book titles. I did a movie. My first movie was a movie called The Hollywood Nights, 1979, and it's a car club movie. And to this day, I haven't seen the script. Really, to this day, I haven't seen the script. And the director, or writer director, was a crazy guy named Floyd Mutrix, and he had some success. He had written a movie called Freebie and the Bean, which was a successful movie with James Caan, Alan Arkin, and he had done a little movie called Aloha, Bobby and Rose, and he had done another movie called American Hot Wax. And they had done well enough, and so this next movie was going to be a cross between American Graffiti and Animal House. So I'm playing the leader of this car club. Newbomb Turk was the character's name. It's a big cult movie. And however, like I said, to this day, I haven't seen the script.
God, I love this business.
So it's like, to this day, I haven't seen a script. So I figure, you know, why don't I have a script for this thing? I was improvising the whole time. So I go to this. I wasn't shooting the first day, but I figured I'd go to the set as a, you know, show of solidarity, because I'm a, you know, new actor, and to see, get a feel of the room. Anyway, I get there. By noon the first day, they're over budget. I mean, they're shooting three cameras, and the great William Fraker is shooting this thing.
Mm.
Great cinematographer.
I work with him.
He's a good guy. And I'm watching this whole thing, and it's out of control. I mean, they're already over budget. And I'm laying low. I don't want them, you know, but I see the executive producer, a crazy guy by the name of Bill Tennant, call over the producer, a great guy by the name of Dick Lederer. So Tennant calls over Lederer, really pissed off that we're over budget. He goes, "Okay, come here, Dick, come here. Okay, tomorrow this shit stops. We're getting a new caterer."
I believe you, man.
I mean, I heard that and I said, "Son of a bitch, they're worried about, they're blaming the caterer."
Right.
They're blaming. So I said, "Okay, that's gonna be my memoir. Tomorrow we're getting a new caterer." But the same thing goes, you know, nobody's looking at you. The same type of thing. So then moving along. So Serpico. You work with Lamette was a guy who rehearsed beforehand and then just moved, right? I mean,
my man, it was the first day he did 34 setups on location in New York City. He'd get a half a piece of a scene. He'd say, "Okay, that's it, cut," because he knew exactly what he wanted. He was cutting it as he was shooting,
right?
But he was also had this extraordinary energy, and he had a crew that was completely devoted to him.
Right,
they were ready to do anything for him. That's why he could get so much done. But he was really hard with the actors, tough. This is what I want. You're a cop. Come on, shake him down, hit him. No, do it. And Al was so generous. You know, he'd just become quite prominent.
Right, he's out.
And we used to be drink, you know, cheap beers side by side. And he was very open about that, very encouraging. Would you like to do it again? You want to do some improv? Very nice. It was a great couple of weeks on that flick. I really resent not working with Lumet again. He was great. His first film, can you believe it? 25 years old.
10 Angry Men, 12 Angry Men.
With those meat eaters?
Yeah.
Phenomenal.
Yeah, I mean, that cast is amazing.
Oh.
I mean, that cast, when you look, you know, just to watch it for the cast.
With that script, you got to have a good cast because some of those roles meld into each other.
Yes, they do.
You got to have
some real character, man. You bring something. I mean, because you had, let me see if I can name them. You had Fonda, Lee J. Cobb.
But don't forget one of my very favorite of all.
Wait a minute, Robert Weber.
Yeah. Jack Warden,
Jack Klugman. I forgot what's the older guy's name?
I forgot his name.
Marty Balsam.
Marty Balsam.
Ed Begley.
What remarkable.
I mean, it's staggering.
And then that very dignified European guy?
George Vukovic or somebody. I mean, it's staggering, that whole cast. And Fonda. I mean,
didn't he produce it?
Yes. He'd done it on Broadway. Or no, he'd done it on TV.
That's right. It was a TV show.
You talk about having venue. You've worked with, like you said, talked about seeing actors who are really generous. You talk about Pacino.
Yeah.
Off the record, I won't mention a name. Let's go to the other side. You told me about a couple of actors, one in particular, who is not so generous.
Yeah, well, I won't mention the name.
Tell the people things that they do. Like, I had Marty, my good friend Martin Landau on. And he would talk about...
What a lovely man.
Oh, great guy. He got me into the Academy.
He did a role I wanted so badly, I would kill for it.
Edward?
Yeah. But when I saw his performance, I said, forget about it.
Yeah.
You take it away, babe.
Yeah, Marty, actually, that was when it was actually... So he wasn't written for him.
Wow.
But Burton wanted him. I mean, it was just from the get-go, Burton wanted him. Yeah, Burton wanted Marty.
But he sure was right.
Because I had worked with Tim on Batman, and I was working with Marty on this Mistress movie.
But
Marty, though, Marty was interesting because he was talking about actors who are not so generous. He talked about Rex Harris. He did Cleopatra.
Well, I've heard nightmares about Rex.
Yeah, Rex Harrison, biggest asshole of all time. I mean, he talked about Rex Harrison, and he said he loved Burton. He said, I worked with Burton, and Burton realized what was going on, how... You know, it was a two against one, two shot on one side, him and Burton and Harrison on the other. And when it came to off camera, he'd fuck up every time.
Yeah.
Just to fuck up Burton.
Sure.
You know, and he said, so, I mean, so is that when you say, have you had the, and then you come to Homeland, okay? Homeland is, I mean, that.
We're shooting in New York this year.
Are you really?
Yeah.
Oh, man. See if there's anything for me. Who's casting? Yeah. See, I'd love to stay here in New York.
That's a great crew, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Homeland's a great...
She, by the way, is right from heaven.
Yeah.
She's sensational.
Yeah. Yeah, she's always been good. She's even though when she was a... There's a child actress...
Can you believe
...who
it?
Actually did well.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, because there's so many who don't.
Yeah.
You know, that's when they're... You also worked recently in a movie that I really enjoyed, which was The Grand Budapest Hotel.
Oh, God.
I mean, was that fun?
I want to work with him for the rest of my life.
Everybody says that. Everybody said... Bill Murray, who's as tough to get something out of as anybody, I know. I've known him for years. Loves this guy. Just adores this guy.
He got a little... Westcott, also, he gathers this crew together. He had this little boutique hotel in Germany where we filled it up with all these amazing, famous people who came there for one day's work. And they were big communal tables, and we all sat around eating together. It was wonderful.
Doing stock.
I think it came through on the through the lens.
Well, I'll tell you, when we talked, I talked to Owen Gleiberman, a critic the other day from Variety, used to be Entertainment Weekly, about that movie. And we said, who knew Ralph Fiennes was funny?
I'm telling you, that's the first thing I asked.
Who knew this guy was funny? And he's funny in Hail Caesar.
I think it came out of that, though, didn't it?
Yeah, it came out of
that. I mean, that's how deep, But I asked Wes how he knew, and he said he saw him on stage do a show in London, and it opened his eyes to it. But this was brilliant.
Oh, that's a good movie. That's a beautiful movie. I mean,
who was bad in that film?
Yeah, no, and Hail Caesar, the same thing. I mean, that his scene, Ralph Fiennes' scene, and the cowboy actor who's going to be the new Han Solo.
Pretty good.
He's the new Han Solo.
Is he?
Yeah, he got the gig.
Good sense of humor.
He's great. And I have to say, the dance number was spectacular.
Yeah.
That number was, the Channing Tatum's number was spectacular. Yeah. We forget Inside Llewyn Davis. I don't want to forget this. I have to tell you a story. I went 2 years, it was 2 years ago, 3 years ago, whatever, and I go to a screening of it, an early screening, and I'm going with my good friend Glenn Frey, because Glenn and I were writing, starting to write a musical together, Glenn Frey, the Eagles,
right,
who we were writing Hotel California as a musical. So, and Glenn and I go together to see this. And when your scene came up, I got to tell you, so watching the movie, and your scene comes up, and this guy sings his heart out to you. And I mean, he sings out, and you're the guy, you're the tastemaker in this movie, I guess. Mm-hmm. You're the great discoverer. And he sings this heart-wrenching song, this folk song or this ballad, and there's just this moment of silence, and you're just watching him intently. And do you remember what your line of reaction was?
I don't see much money here.
Well, I gotta tell you, when you said that line, Glenn and I lost it. We just lost it in the theater. I mean, we just broke up at that point so hard. It was like, it was, what a great piece of writing. What a great delivery. Yeah. What a take. I mean, it came out of, it's just so, you know, it's like when people remind, it's one of those lines, I'm not putting it in the same category, I will not do that, but when I did the Bull Durham thing, and I came up with a line about when the meeting of the mound, and I said, well, candlesticks always make a nice gift, and it came out of nowhere, and that was the line. So shortly thereafter, about later in the day, I'm actually at a luncheon, or 2 days later, I'm at a luncheon for the Coen brothers, for that movie, and I told them, I told them about Glenn's reaction. Now, I have to tell you, they were worried, and they said, what did Glenn have to say? Because
of the line from the movie.
From Lebowski.
Right.
Because of Lebowski with the Eagles.
Not the fucking Eagles, right?
Yeah, right.
What was his comment?
Glenn didn't give a shit. But Glenn just, we laughed hard about it. And by the way, that actor who, Oscar Isaac?
Yeah.
I mean, he is showing with the body of work, this guy's got chops.
Yeah, he does Shakespeare, too.
This guy's got big chops. Yeah. You know, it's like, the more I see him, the more I'm saying, wow.
Good guy, too.
He's
whatever that's worth.
Hey, something in your bio I read, too. This is crazy.
Don't believe all that stuff.
No. Like I said, it's Wikipedia is 97% correct 3% of the time. I've had 4 different birthdays on Wikipedia. I've had 3 different hometowns.
The F doesn't mean a thing. Right. Doesn't mean a thing.
Oh, they got you there as your father's.
No,
so
no.
You just took, you just put an F in front of it?
No, that's all.
Oh, that's very funny. And that's with an F. The bio and the doc. A couple of things jump out at me, kid. We talked about Serpico.
Mm-hmm. That was interesting.
Serpico, yeah. I mean,
take a look at that scene where we're supposed to be. It's cold. We have a coat.
I remember that scene. And
that's 100 degrees.
You're letting them take the bullet.
100 degrees. That's acting.
It was 100 degrees?
Yeah. I don't know what he did with the filters, but it looks cold, doesn't it?
It does look cold.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's when he gets shot. And you guys let him take the bullet. Yeah, they let him get shot. The Serpico. That's just the Sunshine Boys. I didn't remember that.
Oh, wow. That was the last day of the shoot, and he was so good to me. That was a half day's work. It was a big deal
George
for me.
George Burns or Matthau?
Matthau.
Because Matthau does not have a reputation.
He was so good to me.
Yeah.
Maybe it was because it was the last day. I don't know. But the point is, he was just very generous. I was so proud of that work. In fact, I was doing the Ritz when it was released in London, and I went to see myself. I'd never seen myself in a role, really, and I'm sitting in this big old theater, and I get billing. I mean, I was last on a billing.
Yeah, but you're up there.
Yeah, and it was in big letters. It's a first for me. And you know what I did? I started to clap. I was so embarrassed. I couldn't resist. It was great.
Sure.
I thought it was a very good scene, by the way. And I was in, the Sunshine Boys, and I was also in the other Neil Simon picture, Prisoner of Second Avenue.
Okay.
In the very opening, before the credits again.
Okay.
With his old friend Jack Lemmon. Yeah, interesting story.
So you were you in a scene with George Burns or just Matthau?
No, just Matthau.
Very
short scene.
And then All the President's Men.
That was 2 weeks' work, believe it or not, that little thing. We shot that. They tried to do everything exactly the way it happened. We shot at the same time in the morning. They were shooting in the same rooms in the Watergate where it happened. They were shooting from the Hojo across the street, same suite.
So were you one of the burglars?
No, I was one of the arresting officers.
One of the arresting officers.
I met him.
Oh, did you?
I wore the same hat he wore.
That's cool.
I studied his accent, and I was in it for about that much time.
Right.
But it was, Pacula was, that was a guy that, it was a tragedy that he died.
Yeah, it is.
He was a mensch.
Yeah.
And he was a real good director.
Yeah, he was.
Klute was a remarkable film.
Yeah, he did a lot of good movies there. And then, of course, Scarface, which is, you talk about a cult film. Scarface, I would gather, outside of Amadeus and maybe the TV show, you're probably recognized more for Scarface than anything else.
Mm. Yep, you're right. You know, I shot that at the same time as I shot Amadeus.
Seriously?
Simultaneously.
Really?
Yeah.
I had no idea about that.
I was rehearsing Scarface. I was rehearsing Scarface. They rehearsed it as a play.
Uh-huh. Really?
Yeah. Pacino had insisted on that, and they came up with it, which was great for the film, because you know where you are, you know, when it comes time to shoot your scene. And then I got word that they wanted me for Amadeus, so they had to wrangle and make a schedule where I could fly back and forth.
Now, you told me a story about going into the audition. I mean, now, they probably saw 2,000 people for Salieri, I'm guessing. I'm guessing Milos Forman.
Can you believe it?
And you walked in and you thought, listen, I don't have a chance in the world. I just don't give a shit.
That's right. That's right.
So,
but I'll tell you, there was another reason. In those days, it was on videotape. And I would go out for anything at all. If I could get some tape on it. I collected that. That's how I learned how to act in front of a camera. I would study those tapes. And in those days, people were much more generous. And if I brought in my own tape, they would transfer for me.
Oh, that's nice.
And that's why I did it. Because I wanted to meet the man, Milos, and I wanted to do my stuff. But I didn't think there was a chance. Are you kidding?
Which scene? Do you remember the scenes for the audition? Do you remember?
It was the old man scene. It was both. I think I've forgotten. But the old man, when he was talking about describing the music that he heard, that was something he'd never heard before. Yeah. I had worked on another scene, and Milo said, do the old man. And I said, I didn't even look at the old man. He said, do it. So I did it. And when it was over, I looked up to see how it went, and Milos was gone. So I figured, you know, I'm fucked. It's over. I asked for the tape. The guy said, he's taking it with him. You can't have the tape. So it's gone. So I said goodbye. And a couple of days later, he said, I have my eye on you. I think I would like you to do this. I said, what does that mean?
Yeah, really?
He said, well, you have to talk to the writer. You have to talk to the producer. I thought, well, that's that. It's not going to happen. And besides, Scarface was there waiting. Brian wanted an answer. I said, this is what's waiting for me. Can you hold off? Well, they kept holding off, and they kept negotiating, and I finally said, yes, I have to take Scarface. I got a family. I can't wait any longer. So I took Scarface, and then that's when Amadeus came through.
So how did it affect it? How did you work out both of them?
We did. I flew back and forth from Hollywood to Prague.
Was De Palma cool about that?
He was sensational about it.
How was Milos?
He took what he could because I don't know where it comes from, but he really wanted me to do the part. And we're not friends.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't know each other.
It was
a mystery, man.
Here's a question I've had.
What a great stroke of luck.
Yul Brynner played King and I, and then years later he came and did it on stage again and everything else. I'm sure you've had offers. Maybe you haven't. Maybe no one's ever approached you. Would you ever do it again on stage?
No.
No.
No, I had many offers. No, I did it. It's done. I might consider it now. It'd be fun.
Well, now you're more of the, maybe not. How old was Salieri when this was all happening? He's probably young.
He ranged from mid-30s to 70s, which is where I am now.
Right. The other thing that blows me, I remember seeing Salieri, I was a comic on the road, and I went one afternoon by myself. I think I might have been in, either Memphis or Virginia. I don't know where I was. I was on the road. And I used to go in the afternoons by myself to movies. And I'm watching Amadeus, and I am just, dumbstruck by this whole thing. And I'd seen the play, and I'd seen it with McKellen. And who is McKellen, And this movie and the whole production and everything about it is just so spectacular.
Yeah.
It's just a real spectacular movie. And you know, upon multiple viewings, do you know what hits me about the movie besides your... is how great Thomas Hulse is in this movie.
Wasn't he?
Isn't he terrific? Because that part, Salieri's the part. That's one of those parts that there's Tevye, there's Salieri, there's King Lear. You know what I'm saying? It's one of those parts that if you were an actor, you kill for. Mozart's a tough part. Mozart is
absolutely
a very tough part because you've got to be... Such an asshole.
It's much richer in the movie, too.
Yes, it's much richer in the movie. Yes, it is. And I don't mean to, I hope I'm not insulting you in any way on this. I don't mean to be.
Are you kidding?
He's
a friend of mine.
I watch him and that part because he's got to go from being a pompous ass to being a genius. It's a playful rock star. He's a rock star.
Yeah.
And that incredible giggle. That incredible giggle.
And that final scene, completely sympathetic.
Yeah,
was a great scene.
It's a great movie.
He lives across the street from me.
Oh, does he?
Yeah.
It's for those of you who have never seen Amadeus and you're listening to me, watch it. And if you've seen it before, watch it again. By the way, what movie I watched again, getting off topic, because the original Salieri in London was Paul Scofield.
That's right.
Now, interesting, I asked McKellen, did you ever see Scofield do the part?
Right.
And I think he said no. First of all, he thought Scofield was much too old at the time to play the part. This is another actor talking about it. So, and he thought that Scofield was, because he was considerably older when he did the part, I think, in London. Mm. So he said, I don't know if he said he saw him or not. I think, I don't remember. Mm. But I remember him saying that and telling me some stories. Because and I'm sure, like every other actor, I'm sure whether it's Peter Ustinov or Ian McKellen, they're all disappointed they didn't get Salieri. Salieri is one of the, like I said, it's one of the great parts of all time.
Absolutely.
And
I never saw McKellen. I never saw any of them do. I had a real hard on for the way American critics were treating British actors.
Oh, I don't blame you.
It pissed me off.
I don't blame you. By the way, that's the next one on my list in Oscar things. All things being fairly equal, unless he's a friend, I ain't voting for the Brits. I'm really not. This accent thing is, they blow it so out of proportion.
What's that wonderful line? What's the difference between good acting and great acting? A British accent.
That's wonderful. Yeah. So Amadeus comes along and you get this part.
The thing about winning that part, winning the Academy Award, is that I believed all the hype so much that all I wanted to do from that moment on was what I had always dreamed of doing, which is the great roles, always. So all of the offers that came in just weren't up to snuff. And there were some wonderful offers, don't misunderstand me.
Which one would you turn down?
They asked me to take a look at Roger Rabbit, for example. And I thought, well, I want to do the Bob Hoskins part. Well, you say that's kind of stupid. But that's what I was feeling. There were other things,
too. Who did they want you to do in Roger Rabbit? The bad guy?
The bad guy. It was a
great
part.
Pretty good part.
Yeah. Oh, it's a great part.
Christopher Lloyd, right?
But, yeah, and he was wonderful. The point is, it was stuff like that. I said, no, I don't want to be a supporting character. You got to be smarter than that.
Yeah.
But that's what I had in mind.
Look at Duvall. How many supporting parts did he take? He took...
But I figured I got Salieri by insisting on...
Well, you make choices. Some work, some don't.
So it didn't.